Hi guys, Marion here. Welcome back to my channel. In today's video, I wanted to share with you something that I've been personally really diving into on a very spiritual level, and I felt it was time to share with you guys more about it, and that is about Jewish mysticism, also known as Kabbalah. So I wanted to give you guys an intro to what Kabbalah is, share with you guys a little bit about my journey with Jewish mysticism, and really chat with you guys in the comments as well. I'm really interested to hear your thoughts about this topic because it is so fascinating and so personal and so spiritual, and there are so many different views about it. So let's jump in. If you're new here, welcome. My name is Marion. I make videos about being a mom and being a Jewish mom and all things Judaism. So if you like this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up so I know to make more just like it, and definitely hit that red subscribe button down below so you don't miss any more of my videos. And also, you can follow me on Instagram if you want to see more of my day-to-day life as a Jewish mom. So let's jump in. First of all, what is Kabbalah? So there's everything we know about Judaism, Jewish law, the Torah, the Tanakh, and then there's this whole other element of Judaism, which is mysticism. So in the 13th century in Spain, the Zohar was written, and the Zohar is a book that comments on the Torah in a mystical way, and that source has really guided what our modern day knowledge of Jewish mysticism or Kabbalah is. The next thing I want to tell you guys is what Kabbalah is not. So if you Google Kabbalah, or if you've heard about Kabbalah in, you know, the social media kind of reference, you might have seen things like it's spelled with a Q. You might see different sources that are totally not Jewish. And I don't want to knock on those things because I believe that spirituality and spiritual practices all have value, unless they're trying to maybe sell you something they shouldn't be. But in general, I believe there's power in everybody's faith and different spirituality. But I just want to be clear that if you are finding resources online that are not Jewish, that are spelled with a Q, that relate to Kabbalah centers around the world that have nothing to do with Judaism, just know that that's not Jewish Kabbalah. They're borrowing the word, and usually those types of organizations and websites are kind of combining mysticism from around the world. But Jewish Kabbalah is really based on Jewish learning and Jewish mystics throughout time. So although there's been a very modern day resurgence and interest in Kabbalah, a lot of that is not from a Jewish perspective. So just know that, and just be careful with the sources that you're looking at in line if you're truly interested in traditional Jewish Kabbalah. So in the 13th century, primarily written by a man named Shimon Bar Yochai, the Zohar talks about the divine presence in the Torah, and it really dives into our understanding of this divine presence, how the divinity works, how it exists in the world, and it's very, very complicated is the best way I could describe it. A person at my level can't just open the Zohar and read it like a book. It's very dense. It needs to be unpacked with somebody who's much more learned than I am. So although anyone can access the Zohar, I would say it's purposefully written in a way that's a bit inaccessible, because one of the elements of Kabbalah is that it's required or suggested that you should be 40 years old before you learn it. That this deep understanding of God not only requires a lot of knowledge, but requires you to have lived and understood a lot in your life before you can even begin to comprehend these subjects. So what's clear to us is that Kabbalah is so special. It's so beyond just something you can pick up in a book and learn about here to there, but there are elements that anyone can, who is interested, can learn and take in without being a Kabbalist master. So there's a few really interesting aspects of how Kabbalah talks about God that I wanted to share with you guys today. And one is that it refers to God as Ein Sof, without end, infinite. And that is one of the core ideas of God in Judaism, that God is one, but also everywhere, in everything, that he has an infinite identity. Another aspect that Kabbalah talks about is that God has 10 sfirot, 10 spheres. And that is a topic that I find very confusing in my mind, that I haven't really come to understand just yet. That God is infinite and everywhere I get, you know, logically or spiritually, but the idea of the 10 spheres that he inhabits is a bit more complicated. So I will leave some trusted sources down below so that you guys can explore that topic further, but I didn't want to get into it too much because it's one that I don't have a grasp of just yet. I can list them for you and sort of describe them, but I don't feel I truly understand them just yet. Another aspect of Kabbalah that I find really fascinating is the interest in letters and numbers. So in Kabbalah, every letter, number, word is part of the creation story. So you create your world into existence when you speak. And this is something I really identify with. So in Judaism, we say that the world is created each day over again. Kol yom ha'aseh bereishit. So every day the world is a new beginning. And that within our own homes and lives, how we talk, how we create the world literally creates the world. And there's also a real interest in number play and word play and looking at the Torah in that way. One of the ideas I find really interesting is the idea of a soulmate, that everyone is given a letter in the Torah, that their soul is assigned a letter. And when two people connect, it's possible that their letters are in the same Torah portion. And if you really feel this like intimate, sudden connection with someone, then you might even be in the same line of Torah and your soulmate is in the same word. So I like a little bit of that really interesting play on things. And as we're learning about Kabbalah, the main thing to keep in mind is that the goal of all of it is to really increase our connection to God, to find a way to spiritually identify with God. So what I like about that is the goal is not to finish the Zohar or to memorize every passage. It's a personal goal so that you can have a greater connection, not just understanding, but I guess that the more you understand, the more you can connect with God. So for my personal journey, I have been reading a few books about Kabbalah, and there's one that I want to recommend to you guys. I'm just going to pull up my Kindle on my phone right now because I wanted to read a passage from it, and it's called Honey from the Rock, and it's written by Lawrence Kushner. I'll put up a picture right here, and I wanted to just read to you guys one of my favorite quotes from the book so you kind of get an understanding of how it works. But this is a super basic, very intro understanding of Kabbalah that anyone could pick up and read, and I really like it. So here's some snippets from the book to just kind of get a sense of how it talks about Jewish mysticism. Here's some of my favorite quotes. The Hebrew word for universe, olam, comes from the word hidden. Something of the Holy One is hidden everywhere. So it's kind of those lines that like that, that you're like, oh, interesting. And there's also a lot of really interesting explanations of things. So something that the book talks about is how when you're looking for God, that God might appear as an angel within other people. So you right now could be serving as God's angel for somebody. If you've ever felt maybe compelled to help somebody in a way that you just can't explain or, you know, must do it, you might be acting as an angel of God without even knowing it. And the person you're helping might not know it either. So just some really kind of interesting ways to look at the world like that. The other thing I love about this book is it talks about how entrances to holiness are everywhere. They're not just within a synagogue or within a holy place that's been decided by history, that you can make anything holy. And I think especially in 2020 when we're home, that's a really beautiful idea, that your home or your life can be a sacred, holy space and you can find holy moments of time in your everyday life. And I'll just read to you his quote about that. When people become convinced that the places and the things are themselves holy, or that only some people have the spiritual power, then it is time once more to set out for the fields and rediscover the fundamental truth. Entrances to holiness are everywhere and all the time. So I love this book. I'll put a link to it below if you're interested to learn more about Kabbalah. I hope that this video was an interesting introduction. Again, would love to hear your thoughts in the comments. If you've ever studied a little bit of Kabbalah, if you're interested in it, what you think of Jewish mysticism. It is definitely a mysterious topic and it's intended that to be that way. So I'm curious, yeah, what you guys think of it. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you liked it, don't forget to give it a big thumbs up, subscribe to my channel down below, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye!